Hello, and welcome to Ask Dr. John. I'm Dr. John L. Brooks, a Christian counselor at Friendly Temple Missionary Baptist Church, located at 5515 Dr. Martin Luther King Drive in St. Louis, and at 14700 New Halls Ferry Road in Florissant, Missouri, where the honorable, gifted, and anointed Bishop Michael Fulton Jones is the pastor. We invite you today to really take in the information that we're all dealing with and dealing with on a daily basis, and that is systemic racism. And we're focusing on how it's impacting you in your spiritual life, how it's impacting your spiritual wellness. And so, since there's so much information to be received by us in the presence of the Lord, let us have a word of prayer. Gracious Lord, thank you for blessing us with one more opportunity to inform those who are struggling and dealing with especially the issue of racism in our country, Father. We look to you to guide us and direct us, as you always do, and to give us the information that we need to build our knowledge and to gain power against the forces that would have us fail, to have us suffer as a result of even our faith in you. And so as we proceed, Father, we know that you will be with us every step of the way. And we thank you for all your blessings in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Well, let's get started. As we continue our series on systemic racism and how it's impacted your spiritual wellness, we want to reiterate the reference that we're making and how we're defining systemic racism. Systemic racism, structural racism, or institutional racism. Systems and structures that have procedures or processes that disadvantage Black Americans. Now, in our previous session, we talked about hurt, anger, revenge, and depression and anxiety. And I hope you had a chance to go through that and even take a personal test to see if you've been impacted with depression or anxiety. In this session, we're going to talk about how people of color are responding to racism and how Christians are responding to racism and racial tensions. Now, to make things plain here, just want to make sure you understand that people of color and Christians could be responding in the same way. But we just want to make sure that we as Christians understand that our role in the kingdom and what God expects of us as his children. How are people of color responding to racism? As an introduction, people know about the Klan and the old racism, but as Samuel L. Jackson once said, the killing of one soul, little by little, day after day, is a lot worse than someone coming into your house and lynching you. Pretty drastic. Dr. Benita Mehta, a psychologist, commented, while he almost certainly didn't have psychological research on his mind, essentially summed up the serious consequences of what is known as racial microaggressions, or RMAs. Now, racial microaggressions represent a particularly toxic form of racism because of their insidious and subtle nature. Technically speaking, RMAs, or racial microaggressions, are brief and commonplace daily verbal, behavioral, or environmental indignities, whether intentional or unintentional, that communicate hostile, derogatory, or negative racial slights and insults toward people of color. RMAs break down into three types: micro assaults, micro insults, micro invalidations. Examples of these micro assaults. For example, telling a racist joke and then saying, I was just joking. Micro insult. Example, someone saying to a black doctor, your people must be so proud. And then micro invalidation. An example here is a white person telling a black person that racism does not exist in today's society. And we want you to also pay particular attention to the illustrations that help us visualize what we're dealing with in terms of racial microaggressions and how people of color are responding to them. Now, in a recent study led by Dr. Tina M. Harris of the University of Georgia, it lends new and much needed insight into how people of color cope with RMAs, racial microaggressions. In this study, she and her collaborators conducted in-depth interviews with African American, Asian American, and Latino American students. They were vetted by their experiences pertaining to race and had an interest in and comfort with talking about their race-related experiences, both at school and in the larger community. Now, after the interviews were complete, the researchers analyzed them, and the results yielded 4 categories and 13 concepts or ways that these students responded to RMAs. And to the right here is a photo of Dr. Tina M. Harris, professor in the Communication Studies Department in the University of Georgia's Franklin College of Arts and Sciences. Now, let's talk about one of those 4 categories of microaggressions, racial microaggressions. People of color who have encountered RMAs feel rejected and ostracized, and thus have developed a strong need to distance themselves from their white classmates. Racial distancing broke down into four concepts. Alienation. This refers to the perception that one is being excluded from the dominant group on the basis of race. One participant reflected, like, I understand a lot of people are just ignorant. They're ignorant and they come from these bubbles where they've not been forced to interact with other people. They're not forced to get along with different groups or to be inclusive in inclusive environments. But minorities are constantly forced to do that. So we know how to interact with other people. There's a graphic illustration there to the right. Racial affiliation. When confronted with an RMA, some participants needed to connect with other people of color through both formal and informal channels, whether it be social media or just talking on the phone. Participants in this study expressed the importance of sharing our stories and safe spaces. Amen. Intersectional racism. This is the perception that a negative interaction is racist and or ethnocentric, sexist and or classist. Essentially, it refers to the experience of being stereotyped, especially in relation to one's race, ethnicity, and gender. A participant remarked, people always think, in this case, people always think I'm Mexican. Or, like, usually when I tell them, like, they're like, oh, you're so, are you Spanish or something? And Spanish means from Spain. And so it's like small things like that where people assume that, like, we're from all from, like, one area. I'm from Honduras in Central America, and sometimes I feel like people are like, what's that? Mercy. And then racial distancing also includes racial isolation. And this concept describes a response to both overt and covert RMAs that make a person feel that they are alone. In some instances, participants used racial isolation as a method of self-preservation, in which specific places, events, people, and groups were avoided as a means of shielding oneself from racism. One participant stated, the best thing to do sometimes is just walk away. Because, like I said, like, I shouldn't have to deal with this. This isn't my problem. I'm not going to take the time out of my day to deal with something I shouldn't have to deal with. Like, this is unfair to me, you know? There's denial. This category references the resistance, conscious or unconscious, of believing that someone committed an RMA toward them. This category encompass three different concepts: apologism, minimization, normalizing racism. Now, I'm not going to read through this as I did before, but I want you to look at the illustration here showing how people just go on their way. And I think out of all of these, this illustrates normalizing racism, okay? And the apologism deals with, willingness to excuse RMAs and deem that as harmless. And then minimization, entailed diminishing and significance of an RMA. But normalizing this is meant accepting racism as a social norm. People just going on about their business. Well, that's just the way things are. Like, I have friends who are like from New York and stuff, and so they don't see the Confederate flags on the back of pickup trucks, like how UGA students, University of Georgia students, and just driving around Athens, you know, they do. That's so, like, for them, that's like mind blowing. It's crazy. And for me, it's kind of like not a daily thing, but it's like an unexpected sight to see. The interracial paradigm shift. This is when the participants in the interracial paradigm shift responded to RMAs by taking stock of how diverse their interpersonal relationships were. This category consisted of three concepts: healthy curiosity, interracial connectedness, and interracial avoidance. And the healthy curiosity, for instance, takes place when a Caucasian American person conveys earnest and respectful interest in a person's of color's racial identity and or race-related experiences. And so, we can see on this illustration, this photo, you know, this is something that this reminds me of an experience when I had when I was a child. And, the way that my white buddies and I got on, we didn't even think of race back then. But now that we're older, we can't help but think about it. And to be able to converse and to be able to respond to honest interest in the struggles that Black people go through, it's really going to help to bring things to an understanding, at least, and hopefully peace between the races in the future, at least to some greater extent. Interracial avoidance, this concept referenced actively avoiding interactions with spaces where white individuals could pose harm or damage to the students of color in the study. Interracial avoidance. And we see that even in the workplace as well as on campus. Coping. Have mercy, coping is a way to defend against racism, psychological, emotional, and or spiritual effects. And I would say in this case, especially spiritual effects. And how it impacts our spiritual wellness. You know, participants relied on three major strategies to deal with racial microaggressions. Suppression, social emotional support, and spiritual identity management. And we see the impact and how it can impact even our youngest, as well as our adults. You know, to feel that this is not much I can do about this. So I'm just going to deal with it and move on with my life. Suppression. This essentially meant ignoring the RMAs. For example, an African American female participant opted to use suppression in the light of the current racial tensions in our society. She explained, "You just got to ignore it because you don't want to go off and be the crazy Black girl or perpetuate typical Black behavior." And, you know, it's so easy to get caught up into that and to, just move on and in some cases even try to ignore it. But the social emotional support, this concept about turning to one's social support network for guidance, emotional support, and empathy when dealing with racism. This strategy underscored the need to be with family and same race friends. And then spiritual identity management, this referred to a shoring up of one's religious beliefs and values in order to process racially charged social interactions. For example, and this article, I want you to look at this this picture based upon an article that that basically advertises a church gathering and a place where people can come and relate, and even from a spiritual sense, and as well as an from an ethnicity and dealing with people that look like you. Invest in my faith, just help me clean up the mess on the inside. It's starting to pour over into my outside. But yeah, just help me fix spiritual concepts that aren't true and the like. I tell people all the time, God broke down a false concept about myself and he showed me who I really am. And this can be really encouraging, especially when you're dealing with the type of rejection we see in this illustration above. Now, let's talk about how Christians are responding to racism and racial tensions. A racist is defined as a person who hates people who are of a different race. Needless to say, it's much easier to separate and isolate ourselves from a hateful person than it is to love and pray for them. Yet, as believers, we are called to love and the unlovable and show grace to the intolerable. Let me highlight that for a minute. Let me highlight that. Go back. It is believers who are called to love the unlovable and show grace to the intolerable. Now, obviously, this is impossible in our flesh, but through the strength and power of the Holy Spirit, we can overcome our hesitancy and become Christ-like to anyone. The following 7 tips will help us deal with those who are racist. Number 1, build a support network of prayer warriors. And at the end of this presentation, you'll see that there's prayer going on at least Monday, Wednesday, and Fridays. And as well as on Sundays, of course. But build a support network of prayer warriors. And this is basically what Friendly Temple has accomplished through the prayer ministry, to help people get involved with prayer and to basically follow what this scripture says. It says, pray also for me whenever I speak. Words may be given to me so that I will fearlessly make known the mystery of the gospel. Ephesians 6 and 19. And it says here, most of us wouldn't choose to live or work with a racist. Sometimes the choice is made because, they are family members, co-workers, or schoolmates, rather than gathering around a group of people to gossip about the racist. Get a group of people who will intercede together on your behalf. Well, as we know, it can be quite challenging when you're dealing with someone who obviously hates you just because of the color of your skin. And it's to recognize that they are deceived. 2 Corinthians 4 and 4 says, the God of this age has blinded the minds of unbelievers so that they cannot see the light of the gospel that displays the glory of Christ, who is the image of God. Jesus commanded us to love others as we love ourselves. And one of the greatest challenges that we have is dealing with, what I call racism in our face. When someone is obviously even bold enough to shout, and is this group, which appeared in in Charlottesville, Virginia. It was such a horrific sight, especially for those who go back to the days of the civil rights era back in the 60s and even early 70s. And to have to kind of relive this is really a frightening thing. But as they did I believe it was South Carolina, where the nine black people were gunned down by that one racist white young man, they forgave him. And they said, well, someone would say, well, how in the world could they forgive something like that? They understand that this young man had been deceived. He had been used by the enemy in a powerful way, such that he felt his obligation to kill black people. Well, we continue to pray that God would have his way with so many like him. And we see that in a small way, some of the Klan members have been converted to followers of Christ after being ministered to by those who are obviously extremely caring and loving and followers of Christ. Stay focused on Christ and his purpose. Set your minds on things above, not on earthly things. Set your mind on things above. When you are tempted to go there with someone who is sometimes right there in your face, it's best not to even go there with them, because when you do, they're the ones in control. You're the one that always needs to be in control, and God gives us that power, gives us that power through prayer. Colossians 3:2, set your mind on things above, not on earthly things. And like I said earlier, if you continually keep your eyes on what a racist says, you will find yourself consumed with them instead of being filled with the Holy Spirit. Consistently discipline your thoughts to focus on Christ. In other words, don't go there with them. You remain in power. You remain the strong one in every situation like that. Refuse ahead of time to return evil for evil. And that goes without saying. Don't be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good. Remain in control of yourself. Allow the fruit of the Spirit, which is a fruit of the Spirit is self-control. Always maintain control over your thoughts, word, and deed. And so, when you have to work with a racist and deal with them on a daily basis, can be quite a challenge. But here is a challenge, not only to your sensibilities, but also a challenge to your faith. Pray a lot if you need to, and I think we all need to, by the way. Pray a lot, especially when we have to deal with, a racist person on a regular basis. Take advantage of every opportunity to extend grace. Be an intercessor for them, and remain hopeful and patient in God's work on their hearts. And as I mentioned in the overview, we see a great deal of this. You see racism right within the church, or what is supposed to be the church. And this is an illustration of what has gone on in the past, and it's much more subtle now in the in predominantly white churches, and there is such separation, you would not believe, but it's true that so many Black people and people of color are leaving predominantly white churches because of their response to, for one thing, their response to what happened to George Floyd and how it's been kind of swept under the rug and not even spoken about. The fragility of the white attitude has discouraged a great deal. And this is just not what God wants. God wants us all, no matter who we are, to worship Him in spirit and in truth, to love each other as we love ourselves. And so, understand it, you know, once you are truly a follower of Christ and understand the need for dealing with, you know, just staying focused on Christ and refusing ahead of time to return evil for evil. Take advantage of the every opportunity. It says here, therefore, as we have opportunity, let us do good to all people, especially to those who belong to the family of believers. Galatians 6 and 10. Be an intercessor for them. Bless those who curse you. Pray for those who mistreat you. Remain hopeful and patient in God's work on their hearts. Amen. Now, remember, God chose you. God chose you. And out of all the people in the world, it says here, the Lord chose you to be around the racist person. Your life isn't a series of random events and consequences, but rather God-given opportunities to reveal Christ through your life. It's a challenge that many people falter in because of the difficult person. However, you can persevere in the Lord to do His greater will. In Isaiah 6 and 8, then I heard the voice of the Lord saying, whom shall I send? And who will go for us? And I said, here I am, send me. God chose you to make a difference in the world. He made all of us, all of His children, His whole family, the kingdom, to make the change that has to occur in this world. Especially now that we're going through the pandemic and obviously an increase in racist actions. We have to be the ones to stand up for what's right. We have to be the ones to even pray for those who are being used by the devil to kill, steal, and destroy. Well, praise the Lord. I'm certainly glad that He chose me to bring this information to you. So valuable, so penetrating, and so thorough and so complete that it can only come from Him. And so I thank Him for using me to give you information that will help you combat the attack of the enemy and the powers that be that want to destroy our lives. But God says, no, I have information for you. I have knowledge that's going to give you power to resist the temptation to fail in the onslaught of all of the pandemic and the ongoing police violence and ongoing racism that is occurring today. And so, Father, we're just going to have a word of prayer and thanking you for all that you do. Thank you, Father, for choosing us as your people. Thank you, Father, for giving us strength and power that we are going to certainly need to get through this season of challenge. Father, as we proceed with the rest of this session, Father, and with the rest of these informative sessions, Father, we're going to know that it's you that has been there all the way and will continue to be with to guide us, provide for us, and protect us. And so with that, we just want to thank you for all your blessings in Jesus' name. Let everyone say amen. Well, amen, and we'll see you next time.